before we produced our anonymization code of practice a couple of years ago now, we got a big seminar together in the Wellcome Institute in London, and had some very challenging presentations. Some from skeptics who said, anonymization is impossible, just don't bother, give me three facts, I can find out anything you like about people. But we weren't prepared to go along with that easy view, and by looking, by encouraging people to develop better practices, we've got to a position where nine times out of 10, you can, by approaching things in a thoughtful way, make good use of big data without endangering people's personal information. So I think what we're doing on that front, combined with a willingness to be a tough regulator and an effective regulator, but a proportionate regulator, then gives everyone else the opportunity to do what they're going to do, having realized that there's a way forward. You don't have to say all that data protection stuff is the old world. It doesn't work with the new technology. Big data has swept this all away, so hey, let's go play. Your foundation is showing an ethical way forward. The efficacy of regulators is showing the consequences for those who don't, but also, as is our tradition, showing advice and guidance to help. And the reaction from colleagues, whether the business world or the legal world, international organizations and so on, shows that serious thought is being given to this too. I think it's very encouraging.
So Scott, this work isn't over. You are a major funder of this work. What's next for the project?
Well, I think the next step in the project is we actually have to get serious about these concepts and try to begin to put into practice how we might establish some type of an interrogation framework. The very simple sequential process that I showed was oversimplified. It's not tested. It certainly is not correct or finished. But really, as organizations that are trying to balance these tensions of creating good, or quite frankly, in the case of HP, there are big data projects that we're working on that are our data sets. There's a lot of reticence on our part because, quite frankly, I'm afraid of going too far. And that reticence may be good and cautionary, but it may be bad. At the same time, we also have to consider that we are a company that provides the servers, the storage, and the analytic engine. And so from a human rights standpoint, I also want to be concerned and try to figure out how we can unify on a process that as we sell the weaponry, that the people that are using it, that there is some type of unified framework that we are all considering. Some of the toughest decisions we make is trying to figure out whether there's a dual use or an inappropriate use. The more that we can unify around a consistent framework, interrogation framework, I think the better that we're going to ultimately protect the data subject and at the same time reap the benefits that come from big data. Chemistry, I think, is a good example. We have been able to codify chemical structures and then simulate what the chemical reaction ultimately is before the disaster happening. I actually think we can do the same in big data. That's the introduction of types of data or classes of data. If those are codified, we can start to imagine what the chemical reaction or data reaction ultimately will be. There's a data change, as I proposed. That's one step to analyze. But it's the reaction of the combination of data and the resulting inferences that we also need to consider. We need an interrogation framework and to start to make it real.
So I'd like to know if there's anyone in the audience who'd like to join this debate. Those who have microphones, could you bring the microphones forward? I'd like to recognize first Artemi, who is... Artemi, please put your hand up. And if the second mic could go to Eduardo back, who's on the second row, he'll be next in line.
Thank you, Martin. I wanted just to react to the first speech from Cedric because he has pointed out a question that condition many things, telling that there is an obligation to balance interest and rights for approach all the big data question. I think it's not so right explaining that there is a legal obligation under the directive and the jurisprudence of the Luxembourg of the European Court. I think that if someone we could thought that there was this kind of a mandate in the directive or the jurisprudence of the of the European Court about the obligation to balance interest and rights, that has changed in the under the or after the European Court ruling on the right to be forgotten. Legitimate interest is clearly a ground, a basis for legitimate processing, but interests are not at the similar level of rights, of data protection rights, after this ruling. I think it's one of the most important grounds of this ruling, the declaration that is not at the same level, right and economic interest of companies. I think the other premise, that they are the same level and it's mandatory to balance both at the same level, is a mistake. And after this ruling, there is the right to be forgotten, that there is the data protection right which prevail over economic interest of companies.
Thank you. I have a very similar question, but from a slightly different angle. This is probably a simpler question to ask. Big data comprises many things, has many aspects. I think freedom to provide and to access information is probably one of the aspects of big data, because all of this information is becoming available. Since this session is about fundamental rights, my question was, where does the panel or the panel members stand in terms of the balance between the right to privacy and the right to access information, both being very important or equally important fundamental rights?
So, I'm going to do an initial response and then go to my panelists, because I've been thinking, Eduardo, I've been thinking about these for a long time. And I think that part of what bringing ethics brings into play is, when we talk about fundamental rights, there are a broad set of fundamental rights. The rights to access, the rights to privacy are incredibly important. Part of what we bring in with the concerns of the United Nations is that there are other rights that are recognized as fundamental rights that part of this analysis has to capture. So it's not a simple balancing of the economic rights of an organization and the privacy rights of an individual. It's the broad interests of the individual. So when we're talking about this question of educational opportunity, we're talking about the questions of health, of the right to benefit from technology, it's a broader set of interests that come into play, hence the concept of a unified ethical frame rather than a bilateral ethical frame. Would anybody else on the panel like to respond to that?
Yeah, I'll make a brief comment. I think one of the things about ethical frameworks, as I understand them, is that they provide, in some ways, a methodology for decision making, and we know that there are going to be many dilemmas in life where different values may conflict or contrast, and we're actually going to be moving to a world where ultimately algorithms are going to be making decisions, and so how do we build ethics into algorithms is I think going to be another whole fascinating part of the world. I saw a catching headline once: should your driverless car kill you to save two other people. And it's you know, it's not too far where we might have to code that somewhere, that if you're and you're veering in into the path of a car that's known to have two people and it knows that yours has got one, it might veer you off the cliff, you know. Scary, but we're going to have these dilemmas in decision-making frameworks. And I think that generally what fundamental rights, human rights and everything, will be obviously weighted very heavily in any decision calculus in these things, if not trumping everything. But I think it's really just about having that broader framework that, and this partially gets to our Tammy's point as well, is that fundamental rights, you know, will of course often be the trump card, I would say, but it's that whole other spectrum of decision making that we also need this for.
Information commission, some of the information commissioners here are not just data protection authorities. I, as the UK Information Commissioner, have responsibility, as well as the Data Protection Act, also for the Freedom of Information Act. So it's the right to privacy and the right to know. So finding that balance of interest is absolutely what we do all the time. And yes, there are exemptions under the Freedom of Information Act for personal information. And very often judgments you have to make about data protection issues where there is clearly a public benefit in information, for example, public servants' salaries at the higher level of an organization. You don't get very far with the ICO. You're a senior civil servant. You say my salary details and my affair shouldn't be in the public domain. We say, sorry, you're accountable. It's out there. So these are judgments that we make all the time. That's in answer to Eduardo's question of where the public interest lies. But in answer to Artemi, I would say we make a mistake if we are always looking at big data in terms of personal information. Because if we can, from the start, by applying privacy by design and really thinking it through, in many cases we can derive the public benefit by processing anonymized information or pseudonymized information, and we ought to be going out of our way to make sure that we're not taking risks with people's personal information. I don't, even though I have to make that judgment and that trade-off between the right to privacy and the right to know so very often, I do not sign up to the old Roman dictum salus populi suprema lex, and there's too much of that around where particularly interior ministers say, don't you know there's a war on, we're dealing with international terrorism, of course we've got to look at this and interfere with that. The same balance has to be made, but the balance around the private interest and the public interest, the private interest and the public benefit, is one that's very often about information which, if you're designing the research project or whatever it is appropriately, will not be putting personal information at risk.
We have two requests to speak. One back there with the lady in the red, yes. And then Peter is requested to speak. But while you guys are getting keyed up, Milo wants to also respond to this question.
Yeah, sir. Actually, I just want to go back to your comment, and being part of the UN, we do often address these issues. And speaking about fundamental rights, and I said it earlier, yes, privacy is a fundamental right. However, we also need to understand that right to life is also a fundamental right, and sometimes it needs to be balanced and considered. And as I mentioned earlier, for example, if you consider anonymization techniques that are being used for protecting privacy, they might not be sufficient in one case. However, they will have to be necessary in a different case. And at Global Pulse, we are working on a project understanding the necessary, actually, aggregation levels. For example, if you're using and you're working on a project that explores issues for public transportation, and of course, different issues within the private public transportation vary, the level of aggregation could be much higher. But then if you're looking into, for example, disaster response and understanding where vulnerable populations are moving, or if you're trying to understand the disease outbreak, perhaps level of aggregation could be a little bit lower, and the anonymization standards should also be not as strong. And so basically coming to the point is to understand what is the right and what is the duty. And sometimes there's the duty to protect one right over another.
So let's have the two questions, and then we'll have discussion of the two questions.